Valve is back with another huge update, and I also want to take a moment to make a small but important correction. Let's get into it. What's good, Deck Gang? You know, a few people called me out in my last video because I said that no one responds to user feedback better than Valve, and they were absolutely right to call me out on that. When it comes to Steam Deck, Valve has been really impressive in their turnaround time and even their communications. It's been really refreshing to see Valve keep us in the loop and tell us what they're doing. But historically, and more generally, Valve can sometimes have a tendency to love them and leave them. An easy example that commenters pointed out is the plague of hate-spewing aimbots on Team Fortress 2. Even if you disregard the lack of content updates or even Steam Deck-related updates that we'd like to have seen for TF2, you just can't ignore how neglectful they've been with one of their most popular games. When Titanfall was dealing with a similar issue, we held EA to task. Unfortunately, nothing came of it and Titanfall was effectively discontinued. But it wasn't for lack of trying, and it's good to keep ourselves honest when it comes to Valve as well. So Valve, if you're listening, as I said, we've been really enjoying relative transparency when it comes to the Steam Deck. It's refreshing. Please continue this practice and apply it to your other properties as well. We do understand that sometimes things aren't as profitable, or in the case of TF2, perhaps it just doesn't hold your interest as much as it used to. But you know as well as anyone that everything you release holds some minimum level of commitment to the audience that will eventually adopt it. As an audience, we subconsciously and inherently feel that how you treat one thing is how you may eventually treat anything. So if you want people to believe that you will continue to stand by the Steam Deck, then please consider addressing something as egregious as the bot problem in TF2. This brings me to one more thing I wanted to talk about before getting into SteamOS 3.2, but folks, as we get started, if you enjoy these videos, please hit the like button, and if you want to stay up to date on Steam Deck, then subscribe and maybe set notifications to all. So if you happen to be someone like me that has games on basically every launcher known to man, then maybe you have games on the Bethesda launcher. Well, it might please you to know that since Bethesda is sunsetting their launcher, you can now migrate those games and even their saves to Steam. The transfer process was extremely straightforward and quick for me. The only thing I had on Bethesda was the Doom Eternal DLC, The Ancient Gods Part 1 and 2. Unfortunately, I bought it on sale, but like a doof, I mistakenly bought the Bethesda launcher version when I thought I was buying the DLC on Steam. So this migration came in really handy for me. Also, as part of this, you should know that there are some older Bethesda games that are now on Steam and completely free, namely The Elder Scrolls 1 and 2 and Wolfenstein Enemy Territory. I have no idea how they run on deck, but I reckon they're worth a look. Alright, so with that, let's talk about yet another Steam Deck update. A couple nights ago, Valve published SteamOS 3.2 to the beta channel, and it's an update that's just as big as 3.1, so it's a little wild to see these back to back. And just to emphasize that this is on a beta channel, so you won't get this update by default, and maybe you won't want to. Updates in the beta channel tend to be less stable than, well, the stable updates. The first update is, quote, an OS-controlled fan curve to improve the experience in low-usage scenarios, and adjusting how the fan responds to different scenarios and temperatures, end quote. As I reported in my last video, I think this was included in SteamOS 3.1, but I do think it comes with some improvements in this version. For example, the next bullet point in the patch notes says, quote, fixed an issue where OS fan control would not automatically resume after waking up the device from sleep. This was reported on the Steam Deck subreddit as well, where the fan would default back to the old fan curve when it came out of sleep, and they'd have to reboot it to get it to the new fan curve. That probably explains why there were so many varied experiences across the board. Overall, this fan curve change seems mostly targeted at low usage and idle scenarios and doesn't particularly make an adjustment for high fidelity or power hungry games. Of course, the big feature that everyone was waiting for was the ability to change refresh rate in game. This is pretty similar to what we expected. There's a new refresh rate slider that can go anywhere between 40 and 60. Subsequently, the 4-notch FPS limiter adjusts in real time to match the new refresh rate. So at 40, you'll have the option of 10, 20, and 40 FPS limit, as those are values that better fit a 40Hz refresh rate than 15, 30, and 60 respectively. The 40Hz, 40FPS combo is as good and as smooth as the Fox advertised it to be. It's pretty impossible to convey how good it feels, but yeah, it's really good. One of you fine folks pointed out that Turbo Overkill would be a good test for 40 FPS, and you were right. It feels incredibly smooth now in a way that I didn't realize I was missing until I saw the improvement for myself. Frame drops might be more severe, but overall this is an improvement on games that can reach 40 consistently. However, there is this weird blinking that can happen not just when you change your refresh rate, but also when you're switching between in-game and in-Steam menus. I believe it's basically swapping between 40Hz and 60Hz each time you navigate from one to the other, and it can be pretty jarring and annoying. That's likely why it's still in beta, and I don't expect this feature to make it to the stable channel until this is resolved somehow. The last feature is a neat addition as well. In desktop mode, you would have to use the Steam shortcut Steam plus X to bring up the virtual keyboard. Now SteamOS will try to auto-show a keyboard whenever focus is placed on a text box. I haven't tested this out much yet, but I understand it's definitely still an experimental feature, and it's not going to work for 100% of the time that you need text input, and I wouldn't really expect it to. I can't imagine it would ever get to 100% accuracy, but again, it's a neat feature and hopefully reduces the need for the shortcut. Finally, let's talk about how some recent releases play on deck. First up, Teardown is simply stunning on deck. The voxel graphics work so well here. There's a lot going on in this game, and as a result, it's tough to get a consistent frame rate at above 30. Even the new 40 FPS option received too many dips to be my choice here, but the 30 FPS lock works great. Moreover, this game is just a ton of fun. It has some of the best user reviews I've ever seen, sitting at 96% positive, and it's easy to see why. It's basically a physics-based immersive demolishment sim. You are tasked with all types of debauchery, and you have to creatively problem solve, usually with destruction-based means. It kind of reminds me of Blast Corps on the N64, because sometimes there are vehicles that will aid you on your path of destruction. But even beyond the problem solving, it was just fun to hit shit and see it fall. There was an early mission where you had to bring down a dock house, and it was fun to find the four stilts and get the party started by knocking those things down. The house started to sink a bit, and you could see the inside fill with water. Perhaps a tad terrifying, but really cool to see all the emergent systems combine. As a final note, the font can be really small, and the controls aren't exactly made for Steam Deck, but I'd say they work fairly well without any tweaking. Okay, hear me out. What if Peggle, but roguelike? Alright, I see you've already taken out your wallet. Good on you. I guess I don't need to say anything else here, but I will anyway. Peglin just hit early access, and that's important to note. It's currently somewhat light on content and has a $20 price tag, but I'm really loving the concept and implementation so far. It definitely strikes a casual itch, but still has some strategy to consider. Each battle against enemies is a pachinko board where the points you rack up is basically the amount of damage you do against your foe. Each turn you take is followed by the line of bad guys taking a step toward you until they can get close enough to attack you and start whittling your health. And that's just the basics. Each orb you play in your pachinko machine can be upgraded or replaced with some other orb that has special properties, usually one good and one not so good, sort of to balance it out. For example, the Dag Orb does less normal damage but massive crit damage. The Inferno Orb deals 2 damage to yourself every time you use it, but detonates bombs in 1 hit instead of 2. Then there are relics that offer passive upgrades like the Echo Chamber, which deals a portion of your last attack as bonus damage to your current attack. So there are all these little upgrades you can apply to your character to level them up and prepare for the next fight. Overall, it plays well on deck
and is FTD verified.
Ganru 2 is a shinobi-ass shinobi game. Well, strictly speaking, it's a sequel to the Neo Geo title from 1999 Ganru. But you get the gist. You play a running, slashing, shuriken-throwing swordsman in a proper old-school feeling arcade platforming title. In a way, there's not a ton to say about this game. If you like this style of game or genre, you're going to absolutely love this. It's extremely well-crafted. The pixel art is the sort of stuff we thought graphics would be in the future. The main theme of the soundtrack hits all the right notes and gets you into the right zone. And there are so many small secret areas. If you just want some old school arcade action, definitely pick this up. It plays great on deck and is FTD verified. To To be honest, the House of the Dead remake is rough on the Steam Deck. I don't mean the campy voice acting and cutscenes, I love that stuff. No, it's the fact that the default controls are awkward, the pre-rendered movies don't play, and there are moments in gameplay that struggle to hit 30 FPS. With regard to controls, there is a solid Steam controller option with trackpad and gyro to fix the pre-rendered movies. I tried the latest Proton GE and it didn't fix the problem. Furthermore, my Steam Deck suffered a hard crash when I was using this version. I don't know if it's Proton GE 7.15 or the game that caused the crash, but either way, it was discouraging. I'm still making my way through the game anyhow. Like, I'm really enjoying my time with it when it works, but yeah, it's just too rough on deck for me to recommend. There's this box quote on the Ember Knight store page that I really like, so I'm going to read it here. It's from God is a Geek, and it reads, quote, "Ember Knights is a wonderful roguelite that offers a challenge that'll scratch that itch that Hades left behind," end quote. That really nails the feeling I'm getting from Ember Knights. It's an early access hack and slash roguelite with really smooth and responsive controls. It leans heavily on the fact that it's a co-op, either online or local, but I'm playing single player exclusively and having a blast. There are currently 3 biomes, but I still haven't made it past the initial spider boss. There is some light narrative, but if that was what pushed you forward in Hades, then I don't think Ember Knights is going to have the same impact. At least not yet. Again, this is still early access, and the roadmap is promising a lot of updates in the coming months. It plays great on the Steam Deck and is easily FTD verified. Yeah. Inspired by the NES game Godzilla 2 War of the Monsters, Kaiju Wars is an approachable and incredibly stylish turn-based tactics game. There's this awesome B-movie style dialogue and cheeky reactions from in-game units and bystanders. The tactics portion is, like I said, approachable but not dumb. You have to take unit types and positioning into consideration as you try to swarm the behemoths that aim to crush your city. There are light economic and scientific systems to improve your arsenal. There's also a ton of content. Each map has optional challenges, leaderboards, and a hard mode. There are weekly challenges, custom missions, a map editor, and a retro mode that faithfully recreates the maps from its original NES inspiration. There's also a vault of watchable public domain kaiju films. This is quite the love letter to this genre of film and game, and well worth a look. Haiku the Robot is a Metroidvania that is very clearly and unabashedly inspired by Hollow Knight. Thankfully, the execution here is so good that it still manages to make its own mark. It's incredibly well polished and has such a distinct personality and theme. You play as a robot in a desolate scrapyard. Enemies start out docile, but you kill them for scrap metal that you can use to heal yourself or as currency. As you progress into different biomes, you'll find more aggressive baddies, but they still typically seem to be defending their home more than attacking your character. The overall challenge is well suited. There seem to be places where the developer has intentionally allowed you to sequence break a bit, and the bosses are fun to take on. They typically take me a few tries to best, but they're not headbangingly tough. We may all be desperately waiting for Hollow Knight Silksong, but here is a Hollowvania that's well worth a try. Alright, Deck Gang, if you made it this far, I want to say that I'm going to be treating my patrons to a small surprise game this month. I'd like to make this a more frequent thing where I handpick a fun, affordable game and gift it to members of my Patreon. If you want to be a part of this, be sure to sign up at my Patreon. I'm also going to start posting some channel updates in there, so check it out. Alright, until next time, my fine friends, Deck Gang out. Goodbye!